shall we take a look at the first one that came in was from Alpha Arthur, or Alpha Arthur. Can I ask about any pre-built binary for the RTX 2080 GPU on Ubuntu 16?
That is very specific.
That is very specific. So I like specific questions,
yes. And
even if I can't answer that. But so in this case, so the pre-built binaries for TensorFlow tend to be associated with a specific driver from NVIDIA. So like the version of CUDA that we support or the version of CUDNN that we support. So my recommendation would be if you're taking a look at any of the pre-built binaries, take a look at what driver or what version of the driver you have supported on that specific card. I'm not an expert in NVIDIA cards, although I love them, so I don't really know what's supported by that card, Arthur. But if you go over here, like on the, on my laptop, I have I've called up like some of the what NVIDIA say as their TensorFlow system requirements and the specific versions of the drivers that they support. And the one gotcha, and we had this in the last segment as well, that I find when working with GPUs is that it's easy for you to go to the driver vendor and download the latest version, but that may not be the one that TensorFlow is built for, the one that TensorFlow supports. So just make sure that they actually match each other.
Yes.
And you should be good to go even with that particular card.
Yes, and if you have warm feelings and excitement about builds in general for TensorFlow, we have a great special interest group specifically focused on that called SigBuild.
SigBuild.
So strongly suggest going to the community section of our GitHub and checking out the SigBuild listserv and sort of joining it and joining our weekly stand-ups.
Right. So thanks, Arthur, for that question. And then the next question is a really funny one, I think. That how many times have you been asked this today?
Oh my God, at least 12, at least. Oh man. And then the other flavor of it is, well, is this particular symbol that I use all the time, is this going to also be supported in TensorFlow 2.0? And if not, what has changed?
I mean, people have invested so much time building stuff in TensorFlow 1.x. They don't want it to be deprecated. They don't want it to go
understandable,
away.
Understandable.
So yeah. how do we answer? Do my TensorFlow scripts work with TensorFlow 2?
Yes. So, the sad fact is that probably not. They would not work with TensorFlow 2.0 out of the box. But we have created an upgrade utility for you to use. It's automatically downloaded with TensorFlow 2.0 whenever you download it. For more information on it and what in particular it's doing, you can check out this Medium blog post that I and my colleague Anna created, as well as this upgrade to TensorFlow 2.0 video. It goes through and with GIFs, which is the best communication medium possible, shows you how you can use the upgrade script on an in file. So any sort of arbitrary Python file or even Jupyter notebooks, one of our machine learning GDEs created an extension that will allow you to do that as well. And it'll give you an export.txt file that shows you all of the symbol renames, the added keywords, and then also some manual changes if you have to make manual changes.
Cool.
Usually you do not. So to see this in action, we can go and take a look at this particular text generation example that we have running a Shakespeare, takes all of the corpus of Shakespeare text, trains against the Shakespeare text, and generates something that the bard could have potentially written, you know, should he have had access to deep learning, to deep learning resources.
I know you all and will uphold a while this unyoked humor of your idolatry.
I did not know you knew Shakespeare.
I actually played Henry IV in high school.
That's amazing. I was.
That's why I love this notebook.
I was Beatrice in Much Ado About Nothing.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
So while we're on Much Ado About Nothing, maybe we should get back to the notebook.
Yes. So here's what it looks like in Colab form, text generation using an RNN with eager execution. You could export the Python file, and then to upgrade it.
We got to reconnect the runtime.
This is true. starting it, it looks like the requirements have already been. We can check to see that we're using TensorFlow Alpha, and then, like I mentioned before, all you would have to do is preface this with a bang: TF upgrade v2. The name of the name of the Python file was text generation. I want to create an upgrade. Shift Enter. It does its upgrading magic, and very quickly. Tells me all the things that would need to be changed to make it 2.0 compatible And creates that file for me off to the side. So now, if I wanted to run this model, it should be able to train as it would. So let's just check to make sure that would be the case.
And I think a lot of the errors that you're seeing here, it's more just renamed APIs rather than breaking changes within the APIs.
This is true. Right? So you can see that you have some renames and some additional keywords.
Sounds good. And I saw you have some like handy dandy GIFs in there.
Yes, right, absolutely.
So are there any GIFs for those of us who don't say GIF? Sorry, I had to work that joke in.
Well, I'm PB, so peanut butter, it automatically works.
Exactly, sounds good. Mm-hmm. So when it comes to upgrade, there are a few little gotchas, basically, in summary, but hopefully this blog post and your video and all the stuff that we're doing will help you get around those gotchas. Yeah.
And even more amazingly, the community that you were mentioning before, we've had such an interest in testing TensorFlow 2.0 and trying it out against historic models that we've formed a weekly testing stand-up. And also we have a migration support hour that's being implemented with the internal support hour.
Right.
So if you have an external group to Google that's interested in upgrading your models, please join the testing group and we can get you situated.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And a lot of stuff that we've seen, like in Keras models, for example, Carmel had that great slide where she was training Fashion MNIST.
And the code is the exact same.
It's exactly the same. There might be stuff changing under the hood, it's like a lot of the surface level code that you're going to be writing in Keras at least isn't changing.
Yeah. If you've used Keras, you're probably not going to have any problems.
Yep. Yeah. Yep. So good stuff. Mm-hmm. So shall we move on to the next question?
Yes.
I know we could talk about 2.0 all day, but...
Yes.
Okay, we just mentioned Keras and it appears, so.
So I guess I could ask you this question.
Okay.
Hopefully you know the answer. What is the purpose of keeping estimators and Keras as separate APIs? Is there going to be something native to Keras models that allows a distributed training a la train and evaluate?
Okay, so the purpose of keeping them, I think, is there's many purposes, right?
Yeah.
So I think for me, the main purpose that I would like to think of, though, is one that is because a lot of people are using them.
Including internal Google teams that would tar and feather us if we removed them as quickly.
So it's like, so when it comes to like estimators are really great for large scale training.
Yes.
Right? And it's like a lot of time, if you're doing a lot of that large scale training, it's like really keep going with estimators because they're great. You know, like I said, when I first started with TensorFlow, I started like with estimators because I couldn't figure out what a node was in a neural network. And there were all these concepts that I had to learn. And I had just a simple estimator that I could use to do like a DNN or something like that. So, you know, they're there for a reason and they're staying for the reason. Keras is one of the things that from the point of view of making life easier for developers that we've really been doubling down on in TensorFlow 2. And things like we just spoke about, the code is the same between 1 and 2. And it's the layers API, I think, makes it super simple for you to design a neural network.
Yeah.
And then the fact that you can go low level beyond that, and like, you know, define your own layers really allows you to drive stick instead of driving automatic.
Absolutely. So, one of the beauties of Keras and 2.0 is that you have Keras the way that you're probably familiar with using it. And then if you need to do additional customizations, there's a subclassing component.
Yep.
And then if you need to go even lower, then we have something called TF module, and we even expose some of the basic, most core ops of TensorFlow as well. So really, at any sort of level you want to interact with the API, you can.
Yep, and I think there was another part of the question was then around distributed training. Sorry, it scrolled off, so I can't see it now.
Yeah.
But there's like there's something called distributed strategy,
yes.
right? In with Keras and with TensorFlow 2. And the whole idea behind that is to allow you to be able to distribute your training, maybe across multiple GPUs on the same machine, maybe across multiple GPUs on different machines, maybe across TPUs spread all over the place, that kind of thing. So distribution strategy is really all about that. So to help you with that. So estimators and Keras, we love them both. They're both still there. Hopefully this is something that will help you with a question. And I think we've got time for just one more.
Absolutely.
So, this is a Paige question.
This is totally a me question. I am the Python person. So ask TensorFlow, when will TensorFlow be supported in Python 3.7 and hence be accessed in Anaconda 3? So I can certainly answer the Python 3.7. And also I would love to speak a little bit more about support for Python going forward.
Please.
So to answer the 3.7 question, I'm going to bounce over to our TensorFlow 2.0 project tracker. These are all of the standing issues that we have when doing development for TensorFlow 2.0. It's transparent.
I see your avatar.
Yes, I have filed many issues. And all of them are transparent to the public. So if you ever want to have a sort of context on where we stand currently and what we have yet to do, this project tracker is a great way to understand that. But let's take a look at 3.7. And there we go. So in process of releasing binaries for Python 3.5 and 3.7, that's issue 25, 420, and it's going a little bit off the screen, 429. But you can take a look at that issue and see that it's currently in progress. There's not really an ETA, but it's something that we want to have complete by the time that the alpha RC is released.
Yep.
So that is wonderful to see. There's also a website called Python 3 Statement. I think it's python3statement.com. Maybe Oops. It's .org. There we go.
There we go. Yay.
Cool. So TensorFlow has made the commitment that as of January 1st, 2020, we no longer support Python 2. And we have done that with a plethora of our Python community. So TensorFlow, Pandas, Scikit-learn, et cetera, we are firmly committed to Python 3 and Python 3 support.
Nice,
So you will be getting your Python 3 support. And we are firmly committed to having that.
And the nice thing about the issue tracker is it's not going to be a big, hey, we have it, you know, mm-hmm. coming at some random point in the future.
Yeah.
It'll be a case of it's totally transparent. You can keep an eye on what we're doing.
And you can see people commenting and our engineers commenting back with like, yeah, man, I totally ran the thing last night and it's almost there. One more test.
Sounds good. Okay, I think that's all we have time for. So whatever you do, don't forget to hit that subscribe button. Mm-hmm. All right, and thank you so much and thanks for being engaged.
Thank you.